AFSP both to support the development of new researchers and the development of new ideas. Ideas that probably aren't yet ready for maybe more conventional or mainstream funding resources. So one example, for instance, some of the very early work we did testing outreach interventions that were delivered online to people who are at risk of suicide attempts. Some of the initial feasibility funding for that came from AFSP. One of the questions we're very interested in now is, even though we're able to identify people who are at risk, there still are a significant number of people who attempt suicide or die by suicide who have no indicators of risk at all, at least as we currently understand them. We have the ability now to identify some of those people and to reach out to them and to ask them when they filled out a questionnaire about suicidal thoughts and said no and then attempted suicide a few days later. Was it that they chose not to tell us about those thoughts? Did this come over them all of a sudden? This is something we can only learn from talking to people, and it's that kind of really sort of pilot or preliminary research that AFSP provides funding for.
Oftentimes, the person who's suicidal doesn't want to talk about it. And as one of my own patients said to me once, "Doc, why would I tell you? Then you'd try to stop me." And so it's a big hurdle for us that we have to rely on the person's report. We don't have a way of knowing who's at risk unless they are willing to talk with us about it. So one of the big goals that I think we need to have is to identify biomarkers, things that we can measure to understand the individual's risk. Ideally, it should be something, for example, in the form of a blood test or a saliva test or a brain scan, something that we can do to understand whether someone is at risk or not, especially if they don't want to talk about it.
We've developed techniques for imaging the brain and neurotransmitter systems in the brain that have allowed us to examine exactly the same kinds of neurotransmitter markers that we had previously studied a couple of decades ago in people who died from suicide. So with these new brain imaging tools, we went out and we started looking at depressed people who have made a suicide attempt compared to depressed people who hadn't made a suicide attempt. So what you see clinically in terms of the type of suicidal behavior, the sort of person you think might be at risk, we can now see with brain imaging. Why is that important? You know, why couldn't you just rely on just, you know, talking to the patient and asking them about past suicide attempts? Well, it's important because many people who die by suicide die at the first try. They haven't made a previous suicide attempt. So if you're waiting for that first suicide attempt to figure out how much at risk they are for actually dying by suicide, that's not going to work for a lot of the people who die by suicide. So we need some other method. This kind of brain imaging strategy gives us another method.
So the way really to get to develop innovative strategies for identifying people at risk, whether it's by looking at their behavior on the internet or it's by scanning their brain, is through research. It's only through research that we have the opportunity to discover new ways of identifying people and discover new ways of treating people. And the only way to do research is with funding. So you as a citizen can go and ask your legislator, ask your senator to support funding for suicide research. That can make a huge difference.